I don't wanna grow up, I'm a curious kid. The world has 100 questions I can play with. So I'll open my arms and eyes and wonder every day till the day I die. No one really knows why gravity exists. Naming something doesn't mean that we get it. So I'll live each day with wonder.
Dr. Richard Carrier is a philosopher and historian specializing in the contemporary philosophy of naturalism and in Greco-Roman philosophy, science, and religion. Richard earned a bachelor's degree here at UC Berkeley, I'm pointing in the right direction, and a PhD in ancient history from Columbia University. Dr. Carrier blogs regularly, teaches online courses, and lectures worldwide. He is the author of many books, including some on historical methodology, like 2012's Proving History, and others on the philosophy of naturalism, like 2005's Sense and Goodness Without God. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Richard Carrier.
Okay, oh, excellent. Is that good enough that sound for everybody? Right, well, let's get right to it then. There it goes. Okay, it's a little slow there. Get you oriented in terms of historical time. Just recently I got some comments on my blog where someone said, oh, the ancients didn't have science, they only had technology. And I was like, no. This whole talk is a correction to that claim. But to understand the scientific background, it goes back to at least 600 BC. The period between 600 and 400 BC is the pre-Socratic age. This is because these are philosophers before Socrates. And it was widely understood that they were generally interested in studying nature. Socrates was supposedly the first philosopher to start teaching ethics. That's not true, but that was the lore of the time. But what they were doing in that period was trying to understand nature, and they were getting away from supernatural explanations and trying to look for actual physical, natural explanations in terms of mechanics and the way things work. Really, the first originating ideas of science started then. But as they did that, they started to get more and more questions raised about method, how do you argue your position against someone else's, then questions of evidence came up, and then they started figuring it, once they started looking at stuff, they learned way, way more things than they thought. And you get the Aristotelian Age, named after Aristotle, who lived during that century, 400 to 300 BC, and Aristotle's the first person, literally the first true scientist. It's funny, he gets ragged on for getting all physics wrong, but he's actually a biologist, and you can't, you know, blame a biologist for getting physics wrong. He's a really good biologist and did a lot of very interesting anatomical explorations, vivisection experiments, and so on. So his biology is where he's pretty squared away. But he organized the whole idea of the understanding of nature and really started talking seriously about method and so on, and got the sciences going. And by being like Freud, who sort of started modern psychology, even though almost everything he said was wrong, he can be credited for actually starting the science, you know, starting asking these questions and organizing. And Aristotle did the same thing with physics. Now, after Aristotle, now a lot of people think Aristotle was it, right? It's like, oh, whatever Aristotle came up with, that's what the ancient world believed. No, that's not the case. In fact, Aristotle was he just got it started. Then there was several centuries after that of improvement and correction on what Aristotle developed. One of the examples is in what's called the Alexandrian Age. The reason in that period it's called 300 to 301 BC, the reason it's called Alexandrian is because one of the centers of science, not the only area of science, but one of the main centers was Alexandria, Egypt, is where the stuff was going on at that time, most of it. But one thing that it's an example of that, and I'll get to it later, is that Aristotle thought the heart was where the soul resided, where the mind resided. And a lot of people think, oh, that's what all ancient people thought because Aristotle said so. But that was what medieval Christians thought because they only read Aristotle. They didn't read any of the scientists after Aristotle who decisively refuted that and proved it was in the brain. And you're going to learn more about that as I go along. Now, the Alexandrian Age ends with the death of Cleopatra in 31 BC, the last Greek patron of the arts separate from Rome, arts and sciences. And then the Roman Age began. The Roman Empire was basically consolidated at that time, and you have the Roman Empire. And science did not stop then. A lot of people think it did, but no, in fact, it kept going. Important advances were made in that period. The Romans loved Greek science and ran with it. They were totally gung-ho for it. Now, what you'll notice from this timeline is that these are large periods of time, centuries and centuries. Progress in science in antiquity happened, and they were aware that it was happening. But it took a long time because there were fewer practitioners of it overall, so the pace of progress was slow. But it was still fast enough for them to notice it. And let's look at what some of that progress means. Now, if you look at the Roman Empire, this is the area we're talking about, basically Europe, Britain, the Middle East on this side of the Euphrates, North Africa, and so on, in that period of 31 BC to 235 AD. That's the period we're going to be focusing on, although I'll be talking a little bit about the centuries before as we go. Now, what do we mean by science? This is one of the things people think, like, modern science was different from ancient science. It wasn't, really. The ancients, the Romans, the Greeks, had all of the things that we have now in terms of basic fundamental ideas of science. What differed was that in the scientific revolution in the 17th and 18th century, we started acquiring a consciousness that there were crappy methods that we can get rid of, and then we could just stick with the good methods. In antiquity, they hadn't figured that out yet, so scientists were still using crappy methods alongside good methods and hadn't distinguished them. But they were still using the good methods, so a lot of good science came out, as well as a lot of ridiculous stuff as well. But these tools that were the good stuff that eventually was picked out as the things to go with in the scientific revolution were still being used in antiquity, and they were these. The innovative use of instruments. There were still laboratories, and the idea of building instruments to solve scientific problems, that was a thing. Repeatable experiments. Yes, they had controlled, repeatable experiments in antiquity. Mathematical laws and descriptions of nature. They had those. Logically careful arguments from verified empirical premises. That was a big thing back then. And seeking a consensus of experts. All of these things that we think define modern science today, they had then. It's just they hadn't trimmed the toolbox yet. That was the one thing that was waiting to happen. So I'll give you an example. I'm going to start with one of the earliest things they figured out. They really figured this out. They really had it nailed by the time of Aristotle. And in fact, Aristotle's just reporting what physicists before him had already figured out, that the Earth is a sphere. That was all educated people in antiquity knew this. It was well established. And Aristotle cites six proofs of this, scientific proofs of this. I'll just mention some of them. One of which, of course, is if you can see just by looking out on the horizon that ships disappear over the horizon. That's kind of a giveaway. The fact that you have to have towers to actually see them further shows that there's curvature of the Earth. That was one of the things that they knew about this, suspecting was a curve. But they also knew, because they were actually using clocks and stuff, and they could compare notes as to when certain things happened, like lunar eclipses, they were aware that a lunar eclipse happens at a different time in Babylon than it happens in Rome on the same night. That's a dead giveaway for sphericity as well. In fact, that was a clue to how something they could do to actually calculate the size of the Earth. Another one was mapping the stars. They were actually charting stars, naming stars, and they started to realize that where you were latitude-wise, whether you were in Rome or Alexandria, affected which stars you could see, because some stars are below the horizon in one place, but above the horizon in another. That was a dead giveaway for sphericity of the Earth as well. And then one of the others is, if the Earth wasn't a sphere, during certain lunar eclipses, the shape of the Earth's shadow should indicate this, but no matter where you were, no matter where you're recording the lunar eclipse, the shadow of the Earth is always round, which is only possible if the Earth is a sphere. So they had a lot of these proofs, and they were citing them as evidence that, you know what, the Earth is a sphere. Those who don't like it need to get over that. Okay, so you have the sphere. Well, how big is it? They figured that out pretty much as well. One thing they did is they basically just put a stick in the ground under certain circumstances and measured the shadow at different locations, and you can actually calculate, based on how large the shadow is in one location versus another, how large the Earth is. Eratosthenes did this in the 3rd century BC, just some basic geometry. He got the size of the Earth down accurately to within 10%, which is pretty accurate for just using a stick. But part of what you had to do for that was to figure out what the distance was between places. So if you're going to put these sticks in the ground in two different separate cities to measure the shadow difference, you need to know how far those cities are apart. Archimedes actually built a machine to do that. He built the first mechanical odometer. It used a geared system that you just roll this cart along a road from one city to another, and it tells you the size or the distance it rolled. He used pebbles that would drop. But in fact, in the Roman period, the Romans were really good at making things snazzy and steampunky. Heron of Alexandria in the first century AD built a dial so that you would roll it along and it would actually show you an odometer dial how far you rolled your cart. So this is the kind of stuff, instrumentation they were developing for these purposes. Heron also developed a water wheel version for measuring distances at sea with a ship. So they were kind of interested in measuring stuff mathematically. Okay, so you know that they knew the size of the Earth, they knew it was round. Well, this creates problems for mapping the Earth, right? A sphere. Ugh, that's a problematic thing if you're going to draw a flat map. Well, they were aware of this. And not only were they aware of this, but Ptolemy, Claudius Ptolemy, in the 2nd century AD, Roman astronomer and physicist, he was aware that no one had made good measurements of distances on Earth, and he was very vexed by this because he wanted to map the Earth. And he looked at all the measurements, even Eratosthenes' measurement, he knew was off by some measure. It was 10% off, as we know now, but he knew it wasn't completely accurate. So one thing he could do is get really accurate angular measurements off of stars and things like that astronomically, so that he could actually calculate really accurately the angle of something from one city to the next. And he said, well, you know what, we'll just wait until someone gets a good Earth measurement. What I will do is I'll map the Earth in degrees based on angular measurements of the stars and things, and he invented latitude and longitude. The entire system of latitude and longitude that we use today is a Roman invention. The only thing that we changed is, of course, the British Empire decided to move the middle to them, the Greenwich Line. That wasn't what Ptolemy himself did. He thought Alexandria would be the fitting place for the center of the world. But nonetheless, this whole idea of mapping the Earth in terms of a grid of latitudes and longitudes was a Roman invention, specifically to solve a scientific problem. Now, the medieval Christians ignored his complaint about inaccurate measurements of the Earth, so they kept using the inaccurate measurements of the Earth, and this created a problem for Columbus when he thought he'd gotten to the other side of the world, and he hadn't yet. Nonetheless, this is one reason why you really need to read these books in antiquity and listen to what these scientists are saying. They didn't even expect you to treat their writings as gospel. Okay, that's impressive. Size of the Earth, mapping the Earth. What about the distance of the Moon? Well, they did that too, believe it or not. Now, I don't have time to go into this, but let's cut it down basically. He had a stick. This is Ptolemy again. He had a stick, a string, and a clock, and he calculated the distance of the Moon basically correctly. He knew it was roughly 200,000 miles, varied in distance from time to time. It's kind of impressive that you can just have those three things, no telescopes, no laser pointers, or no laser rangefinders or any of that, and actually calculate the distance of the Moon. The tool to do it is trigonometry, and one thing people don't realize is the Romans had their own system of trigonometry. It got forgotten and had to be reinvented later, but they were using trigonometry already. They had plane and spherical trigonometry at the time. Ptolemy used it to calculate how far away the Moon was, and he was pretty much accurate on that. What about the orbit of the Moon? It gets even more amazing, actually. If my iPad will be. There we go. One thing Ptolemy did is he knew the Moon changed its distance. They knew this because they could tell the difference between annular and total eclipses. They knew that sometimes the Moon was smaller than the Sun, sometimes it was larger, so it was changing its distance. It changed its velocity. They were aware of all of these things, and it was problematic in terms of predicting where the Moon would be at any particular time. So Ptolemy came up with an elaborate system of his description of the model, and he was aware that this wasn't the only way to describe it. The reason he described it this way, it turns out, is because he's trying to describe the construction of a machine that would predict the orbit of the Moon. So he actually developed this complex system of gearing, essentially, to determine the orbit of the Moon, and when you do the math on that, you show the actual orbit that it produces, it's very similar to the actual orbit of the Moon. It's eccentric, as the Moon's orbit actually is. It's parabolic in a sense, not perfectly, but closely. And he was aware that it was inaccurate. It didn't quite work as well, and he couldn't figure out what he was doing wrong. But he knew that it was wonky. The orbit was not a perfect circle. The Moon was not going at a perfect velocity at all times. He also developed, not just for the Moon, but for all the planets, Ptolemy developed the law of planetary motion of equal angles and equal times, based on a complex system of equants and so on. That was actually kind of correct, and in fact, when Kepler came up with the planetary law of motion of equal areas and equal times, obviously he's just expanding on Ptolemy. He was borrowing a mathematical law and perfecting it. Now, why was Ptolemy trying to define or try to explain the orbit of the moon in terms of gearing and a mechanical mechanism? Well, the reason was is that the Romans had computers. They did, in fact, they're analog computers. We know this, the Greeks actually invented them, but the Romans were still building them and Ptolemy was still using them. We know this because we got one. We're very, very lucky that one of them just happened to be on a ship of loot that the Romans had filled during their wars to conquer the world. In around 88 BC, that ship sunk just off the island of Antikythera. And in the early 20th century, we found it and we dug it up. And there was tons of cool stuff in there, but the coolest thing of all was the computer. And it's called the Antikythera device because it's found near the island of Antikythera. It's a complex system of gears, a very precise construction of gearing. Here's some of the pieces that you can see. I'll show you some better views of it. You can see some very careful design of instrumentation on it. In terms of the readout, you see a piece of it there. You can't see it too clearly, but there's actually, you can see some Greek letters on there because the instruction manual was written on the device itself. You look really closely, you can see how minute some of the gearing is in this and how carefully and precisely designed it is. Now, it was trashed. It was under the sea for thousands of years, so that's problematic. So what they did is in modern times, we did computerized axial tomography on it and created a 3D model with x-rays. And that allowed us to build one. So we reconstructed it. So now we know what it does. These are some of the designs. Of course, it wouldn't have been made with plastic, but it was made with, it was closer to this, metal than wood was the original construction. What did this do? Well, it did some pretty amazing things. One is that it reconciled four calendars. There were different calendars used throughout the empire, and you could reconcile them all by turning the dial on this. It would tell you what date it was on each calendar. That was the least interesting thing that this thing did. What it also did was it calculated the position of the sun, the moon, the zodiac, and the planets in the zodiac out to about 250 years in the future. So you could actually calculate on any particular day. You could crank it to any day you wanted, and that's what the calendar part was useful for. And you could predict exactly the position of all the planets, the moon, and the sun in the sky. You could predict what phase the moon would be at, and so on. If you want to know how accurate it was, this is how accurate it was. This is the average error over 25 years. If you're holding up your thumb at full length, that's what's showing here. The error is about what's shown there. Typical error was half of the, one of those ranges, but the whole thing was the maximum error over 25 years. So after 250 years, you'd be off by maybe two thumb lengths in terms of predicting where the moon would be, where the planets would be in the zodiac. So this is a really excellently designed analog computer. Okay, so, well, all right, that's physics and astronomy. Well, at least just astronomy and computer technology. What about other areas of science? They're pretty good at physiology as well, getting better at it. Herophilus was the first to really begin the advanced idea of human physiology in terms of actual anatomical study of human corpses. He started doing that in the 3rd century BC. It kept being perfected over the centuries after, and the last true scientist to be still doing this was Galen in the early 3rd century AD. Now, by Galen's time, he had limited access to corpses. There were certain legal restrictions, although we have in his writings, he could get a hold of one from time to time. If you found one rotting in a river somewhere, he would drop everything and just go dissect the corpse. Oftentimes, there would be bandits who'd be killed, and he'd see their corpses lying on the side of the road that someone had defended themselves against, and he'd say, time for some science. But he also dissected apes as analogs for humans. He dissected pigs for physiological experiments and various other animals. And he also relied on surgical experience. This is gruesome, but he used to be a surgeon for gladiators, and when gladiators' limbs would be cut off, one of the first things he would do is run out there and grab it to dissect it. Needless to say, people thought these doctors, these scientists, were kind of morbid. Now, Galen gets ragged on lately for getting the heart wrong and what the heart did. There was actually a debate in antiquity over the function of the heart. But that's another example of ragging on him for the wrong specialty. He was not actually a cardiac physiology specialist. His specialties and his contribution to science was in the vocal system and the renal system. He'd actually fully studied all of the all the muscles and motor and sensory nerves in the larynx, diaphragm, all the way to the speech centers of the brain. And yes, they had actually done vivisection experiments on animals and were actually determining localized function in the brain. So they knew where vision was in the brain, they knew where audio was processed in the brain, where pain was processed, where the nerves went for speech and so on. Which of course proved to them conclusively that the soul was in the brain and Aristotle was wrong. But this is an example of how science advanced after Aristotle, and they were pretty advanced in their neurophysiology given the limitations that they had at the time. So he was an expert in the vocal system, but he's also an expert in the renal system, studying the function of the kidneys and the bladder and related organs. One of the big questions of the time was how kidneys worked and what were they for, what did they do? This is one of the experiments he ran. He measured the intake of water in a subject during a day without taking food. He measured the output of urine during the same day over a period of time and found that these two quantities were more or less equal based on more or less the person sweating during the time. He was aware that water was also expelled by sweat. He also knew to take into account water lost through bowels, but he wasn't aware yet of the fact that some water actually exits the body through respiration. But nonetheless, he was able, with his accuracy, to determine that the amount of water you digest is the amount of water you expel in your urine, so there's a connection there. Now, he hypothesized that urine is water extracted from the blood, along with toxins to expel from the body. Now, the idea that water was being transferred from the digestive system to the blood had already been physiologically proven through experiments before him, so he was already building on the shoulders of prior giants on this. So one thing he did, and this is actually something that we know about because he talks about doing it in public theaters where people would come and see these marvelous physiological vivisection experiments. And now this is a bit gruesome, but yes, he would cut open usually anesthetized pig. So they would only keep the pig awake if they were doing pain reaction experiments so that you would know when the pig squealed or whatever. A bit morbid, but these are the beginnings of science, and these guys weren't necessarily the most ethical people in the world, but nonetheless. So they would, for this particular experiment, the pig would be anesthetized, and but still alive. And what he would do is he would ligate the ureters, tie them off, and then you would see urine build up on the side away from on the side of the kidneys and away from the bladder as it ballooned. Right, it couldn't get through the part where he tied, and the bladder remained empty. And then what he would do is that he would squeeze the ureter and prove that the urine does not go back through the kidneys, which disproved a theory at the time that the kidneys were just a sponge or a sieve through which water went. Water would be reversible if that were the case, but it was irreversible. So he disproved a theory of the time by proving it was not reversible. And then he would section one ureter and show that urine gushes out, therefore proving that the kidneys generate urine. And then he would release the other ureter and show the bladder fill, demonstrating that that's where urine comes from, demonstrating every single step of the process of the production of urine. That's just one example of many kinds of physiology experiments that were going on in antiquity. But it's not just medicine, or not just physiology, also mechanics. Archimedes, famous scientist of antiquity, 200 BC roundabout, was his time of flourishing. He developed the first mathematical laws of hydrostatics. He basically developed principles of the different densities of different fluids and the fact of explaining why things float in water, why they change weight when they're immersed in water, and developed an entire mathematical law of explaining terms of buoyancy and all of those things. He also perfected the law of the lever, one of the earliest mathematical laws of physics, where you basically just write down an equation. They wouldn't write it in our modern notation today, of course, but you could explain why a certain force could lift a certain weight based on the position of a certain fulcrum. And I'll show you just the geometry of that. I won't explain the details of it, but they understood the geometry of it. They were able to demonstrate it experimentally, and they understood this concept. So the idea of having mathematical laws of physics that explain and predict phenomena in the world was already developed by that time. This is before the Romans took over. And in fact, they were developing those laws for what they called at the time the five basic machines, the lever being one of them, the wedge being another, The screw being another, and various applications for the screw, water screw for lifting, screw for applying pressure through the jack, various other different kinds of devices, the worm gear, they had things like this. Various applications of the wheel and the pulley, the ability to create compound pulleys that would actually make it easier to lift weights through simply the design of the device. But also, not one of the five basic machines, but nevertheless well-perfected at the time, was the gear. They figured out all kinds of reduction and other kinds of gearing and reusing gears in their technology in various ways. Now, all that technology started to get applied to industry. Certainly by the Roman period, it started to develop earlier, but the Roman period is when it really took off. Water power plus automation equals industrialization. There actually was a kind of industrial revolution in antiquity. It just wasn't steam-based, it was water-based. And this is the first form of this was the water mill, which uses water, falling water, to turn a wheel, to turn gears, to turn a grinding stone, to grind grain. So basically, they built robots that would grind grain for them. Now, they didn't stop there. They also understood the mathematical reasons why it worked and how to optimize the design of them, because they understood, again, the laws of the lever, the law of the wheel, the law of gearing, and so on. And these things started to get more and more impressive. This is one of the most impressive ones we've excavated, the Barbagal Watermill Factory. It's dated to early 2nd century AD. Based on the evidence we have, it was funded by private capitalization. It was not a government project, as was previously thought. It's an aqueduct-fed overshot system with 16 water mills, basically a massive grain flour-producing factory in the south of France. It fed tens of thousands of people. And that's not the only one, that's just one of the few that we have extensive archaeological remains that survive today. This water mill technology, this water wheel technology, was actually widely disseminated into other industries as well. We know they had automated stone and lumber saws, so they had sawmills that were water-powered at the time. They had automated ore grinding and metal hammering. Automated sand grinding for glass production was probable as well. You had to grind sand into really fine amounts in order to manufacture quality glass. And we know they were manufacturing quality glass, and since they already had grinding, automated grinding, it's almost certain that they were using the same tech to grind sand. They also had automated water pumping technology. Once again, robots to lift their water for them. They also had mechanical clocks. Their clocks were mechanical clocks for water power. And they were even scaled up to the size of public clock towers. We've actually recovered one of the public clock faces from one of these things. So you'd have, you know, town clocks, essentially, powered by water. And this is a map showing how widespread. All the red dots is the known location of a Roman water mill that we've recovered, or recovered evidence of. And all the blue dots are the locations of several. Now, this would just be a tiny fraction of the ones that there were. Most of the evidence would have been wiped away for most of these things, especially since they're built on waterways, which are the most frequently erosive and destructive areas where you're least likely to have evidence to survive. So even just the tiny fraction we found shows that this technology was disseminated throughout the Roman Empire. So they had their own little kind of industrial revolution, and I'll say more about that shortly. But all of that I've given you is just the tip of the iceberg. Those are just some examples of the kinds of things that were going on then. They were also doing optics, experimental optics, and developing laws of physics. Two of the greatest optics experts in physics were Heron of Alexandria, dated around 50 AD, and again Ptolemy, Claudius Ptolemy, the same guy who was mapping the world, around 150 AD. They had developed mathematical laws of reflection. They were in the process of developing mathematical laws of refraction. They discovered the idea of the index of refraction. They knew different materials refracted things at different rates, and Ptolemy was engaged in actually engaging experiments to calculate what the index of refraction was for different materials, like water and glass and so on. He was also engaged in the study of convex and concave lenses. Yes, they were up to that point. And also parabolic mirrors. They're using both lenses and mirrors, in fact, as cauterizing instruments already by this period. Hydrostatics, I mentioned Archimedes in 200 BC, but a lot of his work was extended by another scientist by the name of Menelaus in 100 AD. The Romans were continuing his work. I mentioned he has laws of flotation and equilibrium, principles of density and specific gravity. But they were applying them also to ship hull design, to actually maximize and optimize the effectiveness of ships. in terms of that. But they were also using it to defy nature by making water flow uphill. This is called the aqueduct siphon, using the principle of equilibrium of Archimedes. You can actually essentially use water to push water up a hill. And the Romans were doing this all the time. Medicine, they were doing anatomy, both not just human and animal, but also plant anatomy was being studied. Physiology, biomechanics, there were people actually studying the basic biomechanics of limbs and the application of the law of the lever to how hands and arms and legs worked. Pharmacology was in its infancy, but developing. They also understood basic principles of hygiene, nutrition, and exercise. And they're also developing advanced surgical techniques and instruments of various kinds. One scientist to apply this was actually engaged in using hellebore experiments on animals to determine how much hellebore to apply to knock out a patient without killing them. So they're doing things like that. But they also had surgical instruments. One of the most amazing, I don't have a picture unfortunately, is the cataract needle, which is a really fine, tiny needle with another needle inside it. And they would jab it essentially into the cornea of the eye, pull out the interior piece, and that creates a tiny tube going in there. And then the doctor could suck the cataract out of the cornea, and then the cornea would naturally heal after that. So the kind of craftsmanship that's required to develop an instrument like that is fantastic. But they were doing other things with their technology. I'll scare all the women in the audience with this one. This is recovered from, there's a whole collection of doctor's instruments recovered from Pompeii that was buried in burning hot mud from the volcano Vesuvius when it erupted in 79 AD. We recovered a whole bunch of those instruments. This is one of them. This is a giant screw and gear powered vaginal speculum, but I'm going to be fair to both genders and show something that'll scare the men. This is a bronze male catheter. Yes, they didn't have glass catheters, they had bronze catheters. And by catheter, yes, that means it goes up the penis into the bladder in order to make it possible to urinate when there's swelling and stuff like that. So I'm sure that was lots of fun. Also, the sciences of harmonics and acoustics. This gives me the opportunity to mention one of the very few women scientists we know about from antiquity, and one you probably never heard of. Her name was Ptolemais. She wrote probably around 50 BC, and Ptolemy was also another advanced writer on it 200 years later, in 150 AD. Ptolemais, all of her writings were destroyed. We only have a few brief comments and quotes from later writers who praised her work as being one of the most important that you had to read. So, of course, it was not preserved for us to read it today. But these are the things they figured out. That sound is a wave of compressed air or matter. They understood that principle pretty well. Pitch is a function of wavelength. They knew that there was a relationship, and they knew what the relationship was. They had laws of harmonics and resonance, and were using these laws to improve acoustic theater design. So that was going on in antiquity. Pneumatics. Philo of Byzantium started this in 250 BC. Heron of Alexandria in 50 AD was perfecting it. They knew hot air expands and cool air contracts. They knew the principle of suction was produced by an external force. A lot of times people claim that they thought the idea that a vacuum is intrinsically sucking or nature abhors a vacuum was some sort of law of physics. No, they actually understood the idea that if you took air out of something, all of the air on the outside would push air into it, so that suction was actually pushing. They're aware of that fact, and they were using it to develop force pumps and air horns as well. Astrophysics, they had developed lunar-solar tide theory. They knew that tides were controlled not only by the position of the moon in the sky, but also by the position of the sun. And they were actually developing mathematical theories where they could predict tides based on the location of the sun and moon. And they were already theorizing that this had to involve some sort of force being projected by the sun and the moon that is affecting, that's actually lifting or pushing down the water. So they were actually already toying with the ideas of universal gravitation. They had eventually figured out, not by Aristotle's time, but later, that comets were planets in wide orbits, planets being things that move around in the sky. They had actually started developing calendars enough where they were actually seeing the recurrence of comets, so they knew comets were not atmospheric phenomena, that they were actually just more things in the solar system to account for. They also had calculated precession. This came before the Roman era, but they knew that the zodiac rotates in a period of 25,800 years. What this means is that the Earth doesn't just rotate. It's like if you ever spin a top and you see the top is spinning, but also it kind of wobbles a little bit. So it has a secondary motion that's called precession. The Earth wobbles. It has a precessionary motion to complete one complete precession as the Earth is spinning around. So it's, the precession is the direction that the pole is pointing in outer space. For it to do one complete turnaround, it takes 25,800 years. They had enough data and enough observations to know that and calculate it accurately. That's impressive. And mathematics, of course, they had lots of geometry. But they also had developed conics, which leads you to parabolics. They had their own trigonometry, both plane and spherical. They had combinatorics. We know there a lot this from a lot of references to it. Combinatorics is the basis of permutation theory in modern probability theory, so that you can calculate the number of combinations of things up to, you know, very large numbers. It's fundamental to doing probability theory, and we have some philosophers, even like Cicero, was aware of this and actually using combinatoric arguments in his theology. They also had their own version of algebra. Both their trigonometry and their algebra got forgotten and had to be reinvented later. So our trigonometry and our geometry, or our algebra, is different because it was invented by someone else later on. But the Romans had their own stuff. They were actually using these mathematics in their own versions. And plus technologies. There are automated statues and theatrical displays, coin-operated vending machines. They actually had those. Mechanical vote counters. They actually had a way, the Athenians had developed a machine that would count votes so that you could have silent voting, in effect. They had swivel boom cranes with compound pulleys, powered by people that would run inside a hamster wheel that would lift and drop the crane. But they're basically boom cranes that were on turrets that could operate that way. And using compound pulleys, they could lift vast weights. It's quite impressive technology. They had animal-powered threshing and harvesting machines, water-powered organs and horns. A lot of people don't realize that the keyboard, the piano keyboard, was invented by the Romans, or the Greeks in any case. Philo of Byzantium was probably the guy who first developed it. The basic idea of the, you know, the church horn where you're going, that's using water to actually push air through the tubes and create sound, that's a Greco-Roman invention. Human-powered bread-kneading machines. We recovered some of these in a bakery in Pompeii. Basically, there's this large machines that you just walk around with a lever and you just turn it and it just kneads vast amounts of bread or vast amounts of dough. So they were developing these kinds of labor-saving devices. I mentioned torsion catapults here. I'll disappoint some of the audience, I know. Yeah. I don't have time to talk about them in the talk. But this is another really incredible technology that the Romans, or the Greeks invented and the Romans perfected. A lot of people don't realize how amazing torsion catapults were. They were completely forgotten about in the Middle Ages. No one knew how to build them again. And so that what you think a catapult is what the medievals built, the medieval Christians built, when they didn't understand how to build an actual torsion catapult. Okay, so that's some of the basics of stuff. You know, there's probably even more I could go on and on about, but you might be asking at this point is, so why didn't the scientific revolution happen in antiquity? I mean, it looks like they had their game going on, right? I think it has to do with what I was talking about earlier in terms of the pace of progress in antiquity was slow because they had a much smaller piece of the pyramid of society was actually being educated to the level of doing science. That's one possibility. And the thing is that if your society collapses before you get to your scientific revolution, well, you don't get to have one. And I think that's probably what happened in this case. I'm going to show you a graphic here. Showing the years along the bottom. Now, I use this for a different talk where I illustrate that the spread of Christianity in the Roman Empire was relatively slow. And it's notable to point out the blue is Christian, the absorption of Christianity into society. The yellow, however, is the actual decline and fall of Rome, the actual beginning of the crisis and the collapse of various social institutions and so on. It precedes the dominance of Christianity over Rome. So in fact, Christianity cannot be blamed for destroying the Roman Empire. It can only be blamed for not fixing it once it was destroyed. What you see here, that yellow period, that yellow span, certainly the first part of it, between 235 and 285, there was, or 275, there was a 50-year-long civil war that annihilated the empire, just destroyed many of its institutions, right at the end of which was a Great Depression. Their fiduciary economy collapsed. Now imagine if our civil war, which only lasted 5 years, went 50 years long, and the Great Depression happened right at the end of it. You could imagine our society would be generally screwed. That's generally what happened to the Roman Empire. Their response to this was to institute the same thing the Germans did, which is go totally fascist. And the pagans did this. They instituted one of the most fascistic governments ever in the history of the Greco-Roman world. When the Christians took over, eventually, they basically inherited this fascist system and just continued, ran with it, and made it even more fascistic over time, which was doomed, ultimately. So once that started in 235, things like educational foundations and so on were collapsing. Educated people were being killed off. Books were being lost. Apprenticeships, master-apprentice relationships were decaying as people got killed. So a lot of intellectual, institutional knowledge and stuff was being lost. And you can see this just by looking at the quality of the art before 235 and the quality of the art after 300. Finding artisans who knew how to make brilliant classical sculpture was so difficult that when Constantine wanted to erect his own monuments, he had to go raid the monuments from hundreds of years earlier because he couldn't find anyone who could make the kind of quality work that existed at the time. That's just in art. The same thing was going in all the other fields, including the sciences. So there was this massive decline. The only thing that could have fixed this was a turnaround, and there's a variety of things they could have done which they didn't do. They could have turned it around, and they just didn't. So they were right on the verge of having a scientific revolution, but then everything went to hell, and we had to wait another 1,000 years before we got another shot at it. Now that's the scientific revolution, but what about the industrial one, which I'm going to get to next? For those who are interested in more of this stuff, there's this book by John Loftus called The Christian Delusion. It's an anthology of many writers and many chapters. I have two in it, but the one that's relevant today is my chapter on science, ancient science. And it covers this subject as to why, or what the Romans did, and it has all the bibliography and stuff, if you're interested in finding out the footnotes for this talk, essentially. All of that is in there, but also it explains why the Christians didn't fix it, and what it took eventually to turn it around and get a scientific revolution. So if you want all that stuff, find my chapter in The Christian Delusion on that. But what about the Industrial Revolution? We saw the Romans were industrializing, they were automating, they were actually interested in using technologies to maximize production. So why didn't they have an Industrial Revolution? Why wasn't there a steampunk Rome? I think once again they were close to it, but that's a little bit different. And I'm going to explain why shortly. But look at what they had accomplished so far. They knew about steam propulsion. They had built experimental instruments that could actually spin, they could basically take a cylinder and make it spin through using steam power. They had steam-powered automatic doors. They used these to impress people at temples and with theatrical displays and things like that. But they understood how to use steam to move stuff. So they were aware of this, and they were already doing it. They had the principles of gas expansion. They understood that. They had applied laws of mechanics and gearing. They had all of that. They had industrial automation. I just mentioned that earlier. They even had cylinder block pumps and camshafts. They were even like way ahead of the game on that. But they were using it to pump water, of course. But they also had precision die-cast pipe fittings. We found a variety of these, precise to within a millimeter or two in terms of the fitting. More than adequate for developing steam power at the status that it was at in the 18th century, for example. So they had all this stuff. Why didn't they have steam power? Well, I think it has to do with geography and environmentalism, essentially. And this is back to that industrialization map of water mills that we found. Steam power is only practical with coal as a fuel source. It's not practical at all if you're going to use wood, which was the primary fuel source in the ancient world, or charcoal as well, because you have to destroy wood to produce charcoal. Now, most science in antiquity was happening around the Mediterranean, especially Egypt, where there are no major coal deposits. Now, when Heron of Alexandria was doing the math on this, he could easily calculate that the amount of hay you put into an ox that could turn a wheel was vastly less than the amount of wood you'd have to burn to make steam turn that wheel as well. It would have been evident and quite entirely correct to think that steam power was ridiculous. It was massively wasteful. Animals and humans were vastly more efficient machines. Now, that changed in 1690, and what happened there was coal mining began in England under the Romans in the 2nd century AD, but at that time, coal was just sitting around on the ground. You just walked up to a hill and you just chopped it right out of a hill. It took 1,000 years of mining that coal until they got rid of all the coal on the surface, and then they started mining in the ground, and they got rid of all the coal on the ground, and they got rid of so much coal, but they were using it to heat houses and stuff. They used so much coal that all the remaining coal was below the water line. So now they have to pump all this water out to get the coal. It took 1,000 years for that to happen. So it was late Middle Ages, early Renaissance, that period, when they were in this crisis. And Sayer, of course, who developed the first steam pump, realized that he could do something that was not available to Heron, is that he could make a steam-powered pump that would pump the water out. And you know what it does? It pumps out water, which produces more access to fuel the pump, so that, in fact, the cost of the pump was zero. It actually produced more fuel than it ate. And that was an extremely unique circumstance, the only occasion in which steam power made sense to someone who didn't realize its potential. And then he developed the steam engine. And of course, once he had the steam engine, everyone after him started perfecting it and making it more efficient, until they realized it was so efficient that it was actually more efficient than animals and people. And then you have the Industrial Revolution following after that. And so it wasn't like someone thought, oh, Industrial Revolution, steam engine, we can solve all our problems with steam. That's not what happened. One guy solved one unique, bizarre problem with steam where it was practical to do, and that opened people's minds to developing it further, and that eventually led to realizing that you could have an Industrial Revolution. Obviously, none of those steps occurred in ancient Rome, so you can't blame them for not discovering steam power. It would have seemed obvious to them that steam power was inefficient. It was only in hindsight that we realized that it's a really great idea, apart from, you know, destroying the environment. Okay, so I'm going to stop there and leave lots of time for Q&A. And before I get to Q&A, I'd like to let you know that this is what I do for a living. I don't have a professorship. I actually tour, I speak, write books, and so on. So if you'd like to support my work, please buy some of my books later. I take cash and credit card and personal check. So we'll do that after all of this. But I'm going to open it up to Q&A first. Thank you for listening to that.
I love that you use the word we. Is using it to refer to people 2,000 years ago, doing great things far away, you say that we found this, we built this. Mm-hmm. I'm going to use it. Start using it that way too.
Yes.
All right. If we have a question, please raise our hand. Knock it off with the mic. We are recording this event, so I hope you don't mind using a microphone. Yeah.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. First, let me say we appreciate your very rich presentation and the work you've put into it. I wonder if in your research, you came across any indication that could corroborate or invalidate the assertions that something happened in 10,500 BC, and I'm sure you're familiar with the fingerprint of the gods and so forth.
Oh,
that network. It's kind of semi-scientific to me. I wanted your take on it, please.
Excellent. I can segue to one of the books on the screen on that. In the Hitler Homer Bible Christ, it's an anthology of my magazine articles, academic journal articles, and things like that. One of the things in there is the article I wrote for Skeptical Inquirer many years ago about similar things like that. Fox News, or Fox News, Fox Network, ran a documentary kind of pushing some of this aliens and other theories about ancient technology. What I did as a journalist at the time, not a historian, is I actually went and found a lot of people they interviewed and said, do you think your views are represented correctly? And most of them said, no. So what I do is I deconstruct what actually happened there, and that the evidence doesn't hold up, really, when it falls apart when you start looking at it. So there isn't anything amazing in that sense. I mean, there's tons of amazing things happening in history in terms of, you know, megalithic architecture, the things that, the Stonehenge and the things that were going on in the Middle East. Humans were extremely clever in developing lots of really brilliant ideas to solve problems. That's true, but it didn't require any sort of amazing alien technology or anything like that. Yeah.
More questions?
Do it on mic so they have it on tape. Yeah.
Well, there was an interesting article in the old of it.
Hang on. on what?
it debunked the von Däniken notion that aliens had come in and created all these artifacts, like the Stoneheads on Easter Island and all that. And they had like an old woman creating an airstrip, and she says, "Oh, we know how to strike a line and set a point." And she made an airstrip for them, and all the alien things were found to be easily attainable on Earth by Earthlings.
Yeah, there's an episode of Nova from years and years ago where they brought a bunch of archaeologists and people to try and figure out how the pyramids were built. And so they were building, it's called a pyramid. They tried to build a little pyramid, and they were trying all these different theories, and they were kind of crappy. And then they did this in Egypt, and actually one of the local stonemasons walked by and said, "What are you guys doing? We're trying to build this pyramid." He says, "That's not how you do it." And then he showed them a technique for doing that was super simple and solved all the problems. So good example of like maybe you should talk to some craftsmen who actually do this stuff for a living before you just theorize from your armchair. Yes, so that's the reality.
Oh wait, my favorite was they found some goblets that had pictographs of aliens coming in spaceships and such. And they went to the shop where they were purchased, and they found kids in the back creating the cryptographs on the
Well, that's always a problem.
It was a crock.
And let your imagination run in terms of what science or technology
Quick question.
Sure.
So why does the History Channel have this series called Ancient Aliens?
The History Channel and the Discovery Channel went off the rails years ago. They both do neither now, so which is unfortunate. One of those two channels, I think it was History Channel, used to do some good programming on ancient technology and science, but this was like 15 years ago. I've just stopped watching since then. They're not really generating good content anymore.
This is about, I understand the force of gravity and how the ancient Romans perfected fountains,
mm-hmm.
ornamental fountains, but they were contained fountains, and therefore the water wasn't actually continuing on its descent. So how did they get the pressure to get it up and then to keep re-pumping it up? You alluded to that.
Well, I'm not sure. It varied. There were a lot of different solutions. I know less about fountain technology. I know more about water pumping technology in one of the canneries. Of course, they didn't use cans. They used jars. But there's one along the coast of Italy in the Roman period where it was basically the equivalent of a cannery row, where they were basically the fishermen would come in. And they even had fishing pools, or the tidal pools, where they would collect specimens to be pickled or whatever for shipping out. So they would jar stuff. So they would jar fish, and one of the major products of Rome was garum. It was their ketchup, essentially, which is basically just fermented fish sauce. It was one of the most widely produced stuff. So there was lots of these things that they were manufacturing, but these kinds of manufacturing plants, when you're making large amounts of glass jars, you're making large amounts of pottery, and so on, you need a huge water supply. And so they actually had a chain-powered ox-run pump. This ox just basically walked in a circle, operated a system of gears that did this chain bucket system that would lift water and create, basically, you know, elevate water, and then you'd have gravity producing the rest of the needed functions. So they had a lot of different solutions for that. And we know they were using air power, too. Seneca often, he's a curmudgeon of the first century AD Roman, he often complained about technology. He's one of these Archie Bunkers of his era. He found all these new technologies very annoying. One of the reasons was he lived above an organ tuner. Remember the water-powered organ that I mentioned? He complains about how horrible it was living above an organ tuner. He also didn't like new looms had been developed that were allowing the production of see-through cloth, and he found this very scandalous because lots of women were wearing it, and oh dear. But also he talks about a lot of theaters and amphitheaters and stuff would use amazing jets of water to like Bellagio, essentially, have these like amazing displays using air pressure, essentially. And so it would probably operate the same way as the organ, where you'd use water pressure, like basically lifted water to produce water pressure, and then use that to produce air pressure, and then so on to create water effects and so on. So they were very innovative in terms of how they solved these problems. I don't know about the particular problem you mean in mind. I'd have to look at the literature on it, but They have a lot of ways of doing that.
You mentioned torsion catapults.
David, ladies and gentlemen, David Fitzgerald, a big fan of torsion catapults. I don't have any pictures on me. Most people, when you hear catapult, you think it's like that thing, that sort of cup that you crank back and it just goes bunk and it shoots a stone. When you think catapult, you usually think that. That's actually an onager, not a catapult. An onager meaning a mule kicker. That's what you build when you don't know how to make a torsion catapult. Torsion catapults were actually more like crossbows, except instead of a bow, they had two basically cylinders of rope or sinew, or in certain desperate circumstances, women's hair. We have an account of the Romans needed more material for their torsion catapults, and all they had available were the women in the city that they were being besieged in, so all the women cut their hair, and they just oil up the hair and use that to produce torsion. But what you do is you basically create like knotted rope in a cylinder fashion and just wind it and wind it and wind it and wind it, and then you get like a lever and you just keep winding it, and that thing gets under massive, massive amounts of tension. And then you have basically like two sticks that come out of that, and then you have the string that launches, and you can store vast quantities of energy in that. It's far more than you can in a crossbow. Now, it's so powerful that if you build it wrong, it'll explode, and then the stuff that pops out of there will, like, literally dismember everyone around it. And so they started building it with metal cylinders to contain the explosion, so they started to look pretty steampunky by the Roman period. And the Romans started building metal frame versions of them that were even more powerful. And we have evidence, Tracy Real, she's one of the leading experts in ancient science, and in fact is the world's expert on ancient torsion catapults. She wrote the book on it called Catapult. It's a really huge book, a really excellent book. I highly recommend it. She's one of my role models in terms of a historian of antiquity. She makes a really good case that the Romans actually developed an in-swinger catapult that was even doubled the power of them. Now, the significant thing is that she records is there we have accounts in which barbarians or other enemies of Rome are encountering their catapults for the first time, and they're freaking out because they would be like 100 yards or more away, and they're being shot with these little bullets, essentially these little lead footballs, that would go into their body and disappear. Now, first of all, that's at over 100 yards. That's near gunpowder force. I think they were getting something close to half a small-powered gun in terms of velocity out of these torsion catapults. But imagine the first time anyone encounters a bullet. Normally you think just things just hit you and stick in you, but to have a bullet like go into you and you can't even see, and suddenly you have a hole in you from 100 yards away, it looks like magic, right? Now they built these in all scales. They had hand-sized ones, they're basically pistols. They had rifle-sized ones. They had ones that were mounted on turrets and wagons, just like, you know, the equivalent of modern machine guns, except they weren't automated. And they were building them up to scale up to the point where they were extremely enormous, like the size of a house, and could hurl gigantic stones over walls into cities. And they were working out the actual science of how far you could get a certain weight with a certain kind of torsion catapult system. They had scaling laws. They knew how to scale up the technology because just making it bigger, the laws of physics change in terms of the scale between diameters and volumes and so on. So they developed scaling laws for doing this. And so they were very sophisticated in terms of the development of catapult technology. And it is an example of their brilliance at the time. We have an example of one of those scaling law charts for instructions for building these in Vitruvius. But in the Middle Ages, Christians didn't know what they were doing. So when scribes copied it, they would just make errors and errors and errors, and no one knew how to check the math. So over centuries and centuries, the table's all wrong because of the errors. So no one knew how to rebuild them because they didn't understand the math. The table was wrong. It's an example of the kind of thing, the decay of knowledge in the Middle Ages. Torsion catapults, ladies and gentlemen.
One of the takeaways from your talk is there have certainly been periods in history where a certain knowledge was possessed and for whatever reason it disappeared, and then much, much later it either reappeared or it hasn't yet.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And in the set of the hasn't yet. If, for example, 10,000 years ago they had certain position of a knowledge that died, and they haven't run into it yet, and say 100 years from now they connect the two, that phenomena is no less amazing than an alien story.
Well,
the aliens were here, right?
We're the aliens in that case.
Right?
Yes.
Aliens, right? And I think that possibility exists because, you know, first of all, a lot of time, a lot of things that have disappeared in evidence-wise, and like this wheel that you were showing, this is a recent phenomenon, especially the capability of being able to rebuild it or simulate it, or
what
it is. So it is, it's entirely possible that we run into things that were lost long ago and we haven't connected back to them yet.
Yeah, let me give you an example of that. I mentioned the cylinder block pumps that they developed. And so they could have like 6 or 8 cylinders with a camshaft, and so you'd basically be running so that you could have a constant stream pump, you know, basically kind of like an internal combustion engine in reverse. They made them out of wood. They would take a wood block and they would drill out the cylinders out of wood, and then they would have the cylinders themselves would be made out of wooden casings, and they would be lead sealed, lead and leather as the sealing methodology. When these were finally discovered in the, I think, late 20th century, archaeologically they found them, certain technology historians realized that, oh, hold on, this is actually pretty smart, because pumps are very much needed in certain third world countries like in Africa, but they're kind of expensive. But if you can just build them out of local wood and just core the wood locally, that would be a massively cheap and inexpensive way to not only supply pumps, but even when they break, you can just easily rebuild them with local materials. You don't need to import a complex mechanical, metal, or electrically powered pump. So that they were actually advocating the idea of spreading this technological knowledge so that local communities in Africa would be able to build their own cylinder camshaft pumps out of local wood supply. That's an example of something where we hadn't thought of it, they had thought of it, and then once we realized they thought of it, we said, that's a good idea. So yeah, things like that can happen. Make sure you get some people up there. There's some. I see some hands way up top.
All right, we'll get
yeah.
Thanks. What other characteristics, besides having tens or hundreds of times more scientists in the 17th century, differentiated that scientific revolution from what could have happened in Roman times?
You mean like what other possible explanations do we have for...
Sorry. I guess what is the difference?
Yeah.
Like what defines a scientific revolution?
Right. What defines it is what I mentioned earlier, is the figuring out the need to get rid of the bad methods and stick with the good methods. That sorting process was the thing, and institutionalizing it and spreading that knowledge. So really, the scientific revolution culminates in the development of the Royal Society and then the Academy of Sciences in France. Once you have those institutions saying, this is how you do science, and what they say is correct, you've got your scientific revolution completed. Now, what got them to that point? I think it might have had something to do with number of personnel, pace possibly. But it also might have to do with historical contingency, because one thing that had happened at that point is that they had just started recovering knowledge of the ancients, what they'd achieved. Throughout the Middle Ages, or certainly by the end of the Middle Ages, most people thought Aristotle was all there was. And then all this other stuff started flooding east, or flooding west, in terms of these new discoveries, Archimedes and these other things. And so they started realizing there was more science to know, and that sort of inspired them to actually continue the process. But then there were a variety of other new discoveries that changed the way we saw the world. A new world was discovered, which shattered all sorts of assumptions about how the world was organized. Gunpowder had transformed the world. The compass was transforming the world. And so you have and the printing press radically transformed the world. It made knowledge much more easily disseminated. Not just knowledge, and a lot of people think it's not just words. One of the things the ancients complained about a lot was when you have a book with scientific drawings in it, very precise botanical illustrations and astronomical illustrations, all of this science that you convey visually has to be hand-copied, which is virtually impossible. But once you have woodblocks, cut one woodblock printing, you can just mass-produce scientific knowledge in visual form. This is a massive innovation that was tremendously useful in terms of spreading knowledge. Now you have that just at the time we have the New World, and you have all this new knowledge being spread this way, and you have the gunpowder and the compass transforming the way the world works. You have all of that happening at the same time. It can be really light a fire under people and say, you know what, this is pretty amazing. Maybe then more people get excited by it, more people get involved in it, and therefore you increase the number of personnel, and you increase their interest in trying to figure out how to do it better. This is all hypothesis, because this question you're asking is one of the big mysteries in history that is endlessly debated by experts in the scientific revolution. So we don't really know the answer to that question, but that's one possibility.
With the hope that Dr. Carrier will remain afterwards to answer some questions, let's have three more questions before we say goodbye.
Mm-hmm. I've heard speculation that the Roman technology was held back by the difficulty of working with Roman numerals, the difficulty of addition, subtraction, the lack of arbitrarily large numbers, that type of thing. You described these amazing things.
Yeah.
So were they held back?
No, not at all. First of all, you didn't use Latin to do math. Math was all done in Greek. And Greek had a perfectly serviceable system. So it was different than ours. So a lot of people think, like, if you try to use the Greek system, you go, oh, this is crazy and impossible, but that's because you didn't learn it. You learned our system. They would think that was crazy and impossible. So when you learn the system, it works pretty well. So Greek math was good. They had trigonometry. They had all these other systems of mathematics. They had their algebra was more clunkier than ours because we made ours much more efficient over time. But they had these things. But they also were able to invent mathematical instruments as they needed, just like we have Newton needed calculus, so he just invented it. You see Archimedes doing the same thing. He needs certain mathematical procedures. So, for example, he wrote this book called The Sand Reckoner, in which he tries to calculate how much sand would fill the universe. He realized that the standard numerical system doesn't work. He needed a logarithmic numerical system, so he just invented it. So you just make up the things that you need. You see Ptolemy, for example, is using, and you often hear that they didn't have zero. They did. They actually invented zero. They just annotated it differently than the way we do. They invented the mathematical things that they needed at the time. And we know, for example, they developed combinatorics. All the combinatoric literature, except for one treatise of Archimedes, has been destroyed. So we only have references and clues and stuff. So we know they must have developed mathematical systems for that, but we don't have them. That did not hold them back at all.
Hi, so my question is about some of the math or some of the technology that was lost and then made its way back to European civilization. Mm-hmm. I was wondering what the role is of other civilizations, like the Arabs or other people who lived around there and holding the knowledge for a while and then transmitting it to the Europeans.
Yeah, thank the Celts for a lot of it. In fact, the Romans were good tech absorbers. They loved it when they ran into a new culture. They had lots of cool tech, and they borrowed it. The Celts are one of them. The Celts, for example, developed spoked wheels. And the Romans said, that's a really neat idea. We're using those now. So there's a lot of examples like that. Horseshoes were invented in the Roman Empire by Celts, Germans and Celts in the northern European area. And then this knowledge got disseminated. And then it got lost and then reinvented later. So there are a variety of different technologies they're absorbing from other cultures. But for the scientific revolution, for that era, some of the key things it absorbed or came west, or at least people argue they did, whether Gutenberg independently invented the printing press or heard knowledge disseminated west of the fact that the Chinese had been using a printing press for ages before that, it seems an unlikely coincidence that knowledge is coming from China at this period, and then suddenly Gutenberg has one of these machines. So it seems like that might be diffused knowledge, or the diffused idea in that sense. So there's a variety of different technologies like that. The stirrup is another example of something that came west from the east. There's also the windmill as an example. We know the Romans had wind power, they were using it. So, for example, Heron developed a mechanical organ, a water organ, that was powered, the pump was powered by a windmill. So they had that idea, but we don't have any direct evidence of them using wind power to grind grain, the windmill that we know. The Muslims developed one that was completely different. It was a cylinder-based windmill for grinding grain. It's entirely, when you see the windmill developed in England, it looks exactly like Heron's windmill. The technology is right out of his book, except now it's grinding grain. And it sounds like someone heard about the Muslims grinding grain with wind power, never saw one, looked through the books that they had access, and looked, oh, well, that must be what they're doing, and then they invented it. So you have this idea of the two different traditions coming from two different cultures, leading to a syncretism that results in a major modern technology. Lots of things. You can find all kinds of threads like that. So.
All right, last question. All right.
Got one right here. Quite a trek, yeah.
Thank you. I'm very interested in the pre-Socratics, and it's my impression, please correct me if I'm wrong, I wanted to mention a few things. One is, it seems to me that some of the laws of harmonics were discovered by the Pythagoreans, which was some time before the people that you mentioned. Is that not right?
Well, that's hard to say. There's so much myth and legend about the Pythagoreans. The Pythagoreans were in the south of Italy, which was actually colonized by Greece at the time. Figuring out the actual dates for Pythagoras are difficult to begin with.
Right. But it's earlier than 50 BC.
Oh, certainly.
Yeah.
It would be in the pre-Socratic period,
right.
600.
Pre-Socratic, right.
We actually have some acoustic writings from that period that survived, and in which they actually talk about Pythagorean theory. So some of it had already, some of it already developed since then,
right.
And I think most of it had been fairly well perfected by the time Ptolemaeus wrote her synthetic work on it in the first century BC.
That was
so
my
impression. She was building on the shoulders
right.
of giants.
And Thales, or Talus, however you pronounce it, let's call him Thales because that's what we do.
Yeah.
Thales predicted an eclipse, and he also was able to predict the weather, as I understand.
Well, some legend says. Yeah.
Some legend says. Well,
yeah.
These legends are based on destroyed manuscripts, I'm sure. So why should we deny that he did that? Do you have a reason to think that he didn't?
In terms of the weather, we can't think of any plausible mechanism by which he would do that. Aristotle talks about the legends written about authors, including Thales. One of the famous legends was people often complained about people like Thales and said, what use is your knowledge? It doesn't make you rich. And he says, well, I care more about knowledge than money, but if you want to see a demonstration, I can get rich easily. And so the legend goes that he bought up all of the oil presses in the off-season when it was cheap to buy them, and then when the presses for olive oil, for making olive oil, and then when the season came on, now he owned the monopoly on the oil presses, and therefore charged lots of money and became rich overnight. Aristotle sees the hole in this immediately. He says if that would work, everyone would have doing it. Everyone would have been doing it for ages. And Aristotle points out that this same exact legend is told of many other philosophers. It was a kind of portable legend. It's clearly something that never happened, but it's just something that a story you tell to talk about how awesome he was. And similar with the predicting the weather and things like that. Now, the predicting the eclipse, however, what certainly we know from enough independent pieces of information about what Thales was doing is that Thales had figured out that, I mean, this seems ridiculously obvious to us now, but back then it was revolutionary, that the moon is reflecting the light of the sun. And it appears that he's the first one to say, you know what, that's just light from the sun bouncing off that thing. Once you figured that out, it's fairly easy to predict lunar eclipses, right? So, now you can be wrong, but you can have a high frequency of accuracy because you can, the motion of the moon is fairly easy to figure out. You can kind of figure out where the shadow of the Earth is going. Solar eclipses are way harder to do because the moon is so small, and or the sun is so small, and the moon is so distant, that they have to line up just perfectly, and so the solar eclipse will only be visible in a small strip on the Earth. So it took a really, really long time before an ability to accurately predict solar eclipses occurred. Now, the Antikythera device, that computer that was built around 100 BC, appears to have had the ability to tell you when solar eclipses were possible or impossible. which was useful. But they couldn't tell you where the eclipse would be visible or whether it would even be visible at all. Ptolemy, however, in the Roman Empire, developed a system for calculating it precisely that. He developed a system for calculating the tracks of the shadow of the moon on the Earth using his system of latitudes and longitudes. So that's an example of sort of building on the shoulders of giants again and the kind of level of advance they reached.
When I expressed my appreciation for Dr. Carrier's use of the word we earlier, I was sincere. Our love of science binds us with others all around the world, and thanks to the work of Dr. Carrier and others to people thousands of years ago. Please join me in thanking Dr. Carrier.
So I'll live each day.